Hey everybody, we're here at the 2022 CrossFit Games. I'm Mike Giardina with CrossFit Health, and I'm super happy to have Kristi Storoschuk here with us. Today we're going to talk a little bit about metabolic flexibility in preparation for a panel that'll be going down in a couple days here at the Games. But before that, Kristi, I know we've done this before, but can you give a little bit of a background to just essentially like what you do, what you study, what you're researching as a PhD student?
Yeah.
And then we'll dig into some of that.
Awesome. Yeah, so I'm interested in metabolic flexibility just from the perspective of metabolic health and the association with almost every chronic disease and insulin resistance. So metabolic inflexibility is strongly associated with insulin resistance and all these metabolic diseases. So that's where my interest was really founded. And when I was looking for a PhD opportunity, the lab that I chose looks at muscle physiology, and metabolic flexibility really comes down to the skeletal muscle. That's the organ that we're really interested in, because that's our most metabolically active organ, responsible for glucose metabolism and lipid metabolism. So I'm doing my PhD research on metabolic flexibility, and we're an exercise physiology lab, so I'm incorporating exercise, of course, but also trying to loop in the nutritional side of things and nutrition timing. So.
Perfect. That kind of leads right into the questions that we want to talk about here. So, question number one. For everybody, can you provide a pretty solid definition of what metabolic flexibility is?
Yeah, so at the cellular level, metabolic flexibility is essentially being able to adapt to fuel availability. So usage, it would be match to availability. So if carbohydrates are available, we use carbohydrates. If glucose availability drops, we now switch over to lipid metabolism or fat metabolism. And being able to fluidly switch between the two is metabolic flexibility. I guess that's the
perfect
definition.
Perfect. Let me do one more, and then we'll so how does metabolic flexibility associated with improved health outcomes, and is it also associated with improved performance outcomes?
That's a good question. So we know that elite athletes have very pristine metabolic flexibility. So if you look at their rates of fat oxidation during exercise, elite athletes are able to max out their fat oxidation at a much higher work output than a recreationally active individual. And then that is then below that is a metabolically impaired individual. So that would be a marker of metabolic inflexibility, because exercise is the stimulus to increase fat oxidation. And if you're metabolically inflexible, you're unable to burn fat appropriately. So then you're switching into this glycolytic state at such a low workload compared to athletes. So exercise is definitely a stimulus to improve metabolic flexibility, but it's also a way to assess metabolic flexibility.
Oh, cool. Really cool. Okay, well then let's talk about different ways to improve metabolic flexibility. So when you first introduced it, you were talking about exercise as a way to improve it, then also nutrition. So can you provide a bit of a compare and contrast for both approaches on improving metabolic flexibility?
Yeah, so I came into this world very focused on ketogenic diets, ketogenic nutrition, fasting, and there's a lot of talk around those methods for improving metabolic flexibility. But I've been humbled by my PhD experience so far, and it looks like exercise is the only real physiological stress to make that switch and adaptations that make us more metabolically flexible. So it's interesting, because a lot of reviews that are published on metabolic flexibility and nutritional strategies to improve metabolic flexibility will reference intermittent fasting, ketogenic diets as a way to improve it. And they'll use animal data to support the rationale, but these findings have not been replicated in humans so far. So for example, this might be a little technical, but there's a certain gene called PGC1 alpha, and this is the master regulator of mitochondrial biogenesis, okay, which is just the creation of new mitochondria, right, in our skeletal muscle. And that increases in response to fasting in animal models, and that is a potent response, and it's been replicated many times, mm-hmm. but it's not replicated so far in humans, and that's not a response that we see. So it doesn't seem that fasting is a metabolic stress for skeletal muscle. So, and our muscles respond to stress by adapting, creating new mitochondria. New mitochondria makes us more metabolically flexible, sure. because now we're able to burn more fat. We have greater oxidative capacity. So it's just been interesting to compare or to just dig into the literature on fasting for improving metabolic flexibility at the level of the muscle, because these molecular markers that we often think like we see cited, they're really only seen in animal models, and our metabolic rate is very different from animals. Okay, yeah. So that's probably a big reason. But it's just that fasting and like our muscles really like to use fat. So at rest, we're using fat. During low intensity exercise, we're using fat for fuel. And in order to really stress our muscles, it looks like exercise is the only way to do that. And then that stress is what we adapt to become bigger and better and stronger and more metabolically flexible. So I'm under the impression that exercise is really the only stimulus for improving metabolic flexibility at the level of the muscle, if we're focused on like mitochondrial content and oxidative capacity.
Is mitochondrial density one of the major factors here that we're talking about?
Yeah, so if we're thinking about metabolic flexibility, mitochondria are super important.
And is there a certain exercise type that is more conducive to improving metabolic flexibility or increasing the amount of mitochondria that we have inside the muscle cell?
That's a good question. It's a little controversial. Like a lot of people think like, oh, zone two training,
right,
we're at this fat max and we're just below lactate threshold. We're gonna ride that out for long periods of time. But you can get that adaptation from shorter duration, higher intensity exercise.
Yeah.
So I'm a little confused because there's a lot of different experts talking about all different things. And if I were to just go with based on what the literature says, it looks like high intensity exercise is, you can get the same benefit in a shorter amount of time just by doing higher intensity.
It seems like the process of it, how can I explain this in the way that my brain would wrap my head around it, but like, on low, let's say zone two cardio, it's the activity itself, like during that activity that might produce these adaptations and the stress, and then maybe something on like high intensity training, the recovery process, like bringing things back to homeostasis where you use a lot more, where there's a lot more like oxidative capacity that takes place, or?
Yeah, it's just that molecularly, like we adapt to the stress, and high intensity exercise induces a greater stress.
Okay.
So zone two training isn't that big of a stress for our muscle.
No.
Like our muscles love to use fat. So once we get into higher intensities, we're now activating like AMPK, and that downstream from that's PGC1 alpha, and then we're getting these mitochondrial adaptations.
Okay.
So that's where my confusion is, because like high intensity seems like that's the better option, or just just alternative and different time domains for different intensities. But the higher intensities, the less amount of time you have to spend exercising.
So maybe the most bang for your buck is kind of, you know, the CrossFit approach, right? A lot of your workouts high intensity, every once in a while throwing something long and low intensity.
Yeah, I mean, my unbiased opinion is that CrossFit is great.
Well, if you look around at the CrossFit Games, it looks like there's some pretty metabolically healthy people around
there. So. But I think the main message also is just like, choose a type of exercise that you enjoy doing, because anything is better than nothing.
For sure.
But yeah, pushing yourself into those higher intensities, I personally think is a good, and like mixing it up as well too. So CrossFit.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, I think that's some really cool insight into metabolic flexibility, and it's a lot different than what I think is, I don't know if you call it mainstream, or what we hear a lot more often is this nutritional approach, and not a lot of focus on exercise for increasing metabolic flexibility. So it's a really cool way to understand it and think about it, and then apply training towards improving health.
Awesome. I will add one more thing.
Yeah.
This is just to do with specifically with fasting. So again, we think of fasting as improving metabolic flexibility because we're emptying our liver glycogen, we're switching into fat oxidation, we're increasing ketones. And that is, I guess, metabolic flexibility, or at least a practice of practicing metabolic flexibility. But doing like prolonged fasts, so like 48 hours, yeah, up to 72 hours, we actually accumulate lipids in our muscles and down-regulate our insulin signaling pathways, or glucose metabolism pathways. So that is an acute state of metabolic inflexibility, sure, because now you're reducing your carbohydrate tolerance. But there was a really cool study that showed doing a bout of exercise at the end of a prolonged fast overcame that fasting-induced insulin resistance. It's physiological. It's not meant to scare anyone. It's sure, a normal response. But it's just really cool how powerful exercise is in regulating our metabolism and overcoming almost all forms of insulin resistance. So if your insulin resistance is induced by diet and being overweight or sedentary, or if it's induced by a fast, you can use exercise as a way to reverse insulin resistance. And that to me is really cool because it just shows the power of exercise and like being able to maintain physical activity through life, I think is the most important thing we can do if we want to maintain our insulin sensitivity.
I think that's awesome. And I have one follow-up question and it just popped in my head. So and if you don't know, it's fine.
Yeah.
But so if you had a bad night, lack of sleep sometimes can have a detrimental effect on insulin sensitivity, right?
Mm-hmm.
So could you follow, and maybe it's a bad idea, but could you follow up a day of like low sleep, but maybe not a crazy workout, but at least with some exercise to improve that throughout the day?
Yeah, there was a study where they induced like a sleep deprivation. And then they did a bout of high-intensity exercise the next day and showed that high-intensity exercise reversed the metabolic derangements induced by that
wow,
sleep deprivation.
Really?
I mean, I'm not suggesting we should just be pushing ourselves
oh, yeah,
through and like
that's
everything.
I was careful asking that, you know, like still get your sleep.
Yeah, just don't sleep and just do high-intensity exercise. That's the answer. But no, that there was a study that looked at that, which is really neat. Yeah.
Really cool. Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, Kristi, thank you so much for being here with us again. I think this is great information for the community, and yeah, can't wait till the next time.
Cool. Thanks, Mike.
Awesome. Thank you.